baseball classic. You play for your country. Day has turned to night in Miami, and Team USA tonight has an opportunity to control its own destiny to advance in the tournament. The only thing standing in the way at Marlins Park, Team Canada. Welcome to this World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network, presented by GEICO. The final game in Pool C, barring a tiebreaker needed tomorrow, Team USA and Canada. Well, these two teams have some act to follow after the stirring game to open the day-night doubleheader, the Dominican Republic defeating Colombia. The DR moves on to San Diego next week with a perfect pool record of 3-0. The United States needs only to win today, beat Canada, and join them as the top two teams advancing in the tournament. With that, we welcome you back inside Marlins Park. A long day of baseball and more to come with the nightcap in store. John Smoltz, Matt Bascurge, and J.P. Morosi with us as well. This is what the Team USA could have asked for: a chance to control their own fate, win, and move on.
Well, last night caused this game to really matter. Of course, if they won last night, they would be playing this game, but not with the urgency they have, and that is they need to win so they can go to San Diego. A lot of pressure on them. Just do the little things. Do the things you have to do to make sure you move on. And there's another scenario, but they don't want to think about that another scenario once they if they lose. So they're thinking about winning again.
Yeah, we don't want to think about it either, because it's really confusing when you start talking about tiebreakers and runs allowed. So let's talk about the pitching matchup. The U.S. will face a familiar face and a familiar arm. Ryan Dempster started Canada's opener against the Dominican Republic. He gave up 4 runs on 7 hits in 2 innings. He gets the ball again for manager Ernie Witt, and on the mound for the U.S., Royals ace Danny Duffy.
Yeah, Danny Duffy, of course, he is their ace, and this is a hard-throwing left-hander with a lot of stuff, and his goal is to pass the baton on. For Ryan Dempster, he's not tied to anything, so basically he's going to give Canada whatever he can, maybe the full allotment of pitches if everything goes right.
Again, if Team USA wins, if they can defeat Canada, they move on automatically. If not, there are all kinds of runs allowed scenarios that will build into the telecast as we get cooking. That would give Canada a chance, that would give the U.S. a slight chance, and that would mean Colombia would join the Dominican in San Diego. Let's make it clear. The U.S. wins and they move on, something everybody knows in the U.S. clubhouse. And in fact, our J.P. Morosi is standing by with one of the United States stars, shortstop Brandon Crawford.
Thanks, Matt. Well, Brandon Crawford, you've seen a lot in baseball. 2 World Series rings. What can you say about last night's game and then today as a spectator watching what happened there with the Colombia and the DR?
Baseball's crazy. You know, these games have been a lot of fun. You know, especially for the middle of March, when usually we're playing spring training games that can get kind of long. These are awesome. You know, the crowd's into it. The Dominican crowd last night was unlike any other crowd I think I've seen. And we get some pretty good fans in San Francisco, but that was different. It almost felt like it had like a soccer game feel to it, banging on the drums and playing music the whole game. It's a lot of fun, though.
So tonight, obviously, a tough loss last night. How have you noticed your teammates regrouping after the tough defeat last night?
I think just like we do with the Giants, you know, you kind of wipe it off and play the next one. We know we have to win to advance right here, unless we want to play a tiebreaker tomorrow, which I don't think anybody wants to do that. So, you know, we know we have to get out there and get the job done tonight and not worry about what happened last night.
Brandon, thanks so much.
All right, no problem.
Matt, back to you.
Yeah, JP, what happened last night seems like it was a week ago, talking about giving up the 5-0 lead to the Dominican Republic. So the U.S. gets a reprieve. They beat Canada, and they move on in the tournament anyway. And nobody's panicking down there. You could see it in Brandon Crawford's face.
Yeah, this is a veteran club in the sense that they've done this during the year so many times. A lot of teams have dealt with bad losses. And just the fact that you get to go back out and play, they knew they had to play 3 games. They felt they had to win 2. They take care of business. Nobody cares about what happens leading up to it.
Yeah, many of the U.S. stars really haven't heated up either, so perhaps the best is yet to come for Team USA in this tournament. After a quick break, Adam Jones and the Americans taking on Ryan Dempster and Team Canada. Freddie Freeman's ready to go, so's Big Giancarlo Stanton. We're back with the lineups and the first pitch coming up next. Here's how Ernie Witt and Team Canada line up for their final game in pool play, taking on the Americans. Pete Orr, Eric Wood, and Freddie Freeman lead it off. Tyler O'Neill's a top Seattle Mariners prospect. He's in left field batting cleanup. Justin Morneau thinks there's something left. He wants to play again in the big leagues this year. DHing batting number 5, Jamie Romack, Rene Tassone, veteran catcher George Gutsaris, and Jonathan Mollo round things out for the Canadians. And on the mound for Team USA, Royals ace Danny Duffy, coming off a career year in 2016, 12-3, reaching career highs in wins, innings pitched, and Ks per 9.
You don't have to do anything heroic. You just have to do your job, throw strikes, and just pass the baton on to the next guy that comes in after you. Hopefully you got the lead, but attack this lineup.
Our nightcap is underway with strike 1. Pete Orr with a swing and a miss. Danny Duffy beginning his WBC career officially tonight. He played for the U.S. back in 2010 in the Pan Am qualifiers. This is his first real international competition since then, as Pete Orr fades a foul ball to fall behind 0-2.
He, like a lot of, I don't want to call them new age pitchers, but have adopted this kind of side straddle windup. It's not really even a windup. Looks like he pitches out of the stretch, a la David Price. David Price got a little action, but he's just bringing his legs up and down and pitching out of the stretch. So he's condensed his mechanics, and it's helped his command. He feels comfortable staying in this position. Personally, I always like seeing guys as a starter utilizing the windup as some form of deception towards the hitter.
2 balls and 2 strikes to Pete Orr. Hard to imagine Danny Duffy thinking back to this time last year. Began the season in the bullpen in Kansas City, moved into the rotation at Med Bay, and ended the year as their number one starter.
The reason I say I like pitchers to pitch out of the windup, you create. I mean, technically, could you throw a little bit harder out of the windup? I guess, but you create something for the hitter as he's got to learn how to time your mechanics. Out of the stretch, it's kind of one piece. It's the hitter's looking at you coming as if there were runners on. There's not really much to it. So each pitcher does it.
And a called strike 3 taken by Pete Orr. Duffy is murder on left-handed hitters. Limited them to a 449 opponent's OPS last year, 5th best in the big leagues.
So for Danny Duffy, here's what I think has got to be essential for tonight. Fastball command. As long as he attacks with his fastball, he's going to be fine. And then that slider. His slider's awfully difficult, especially on left-handers. And then give him innings. Survive and advance. Give him some innings and give the bullpen the opportunity to shorten the game.
One gone for Eric Wood, the third baseman tonight.
Can I just tell you what I want to do tonight?
What's that?
I want to have the first game of which I keep score through 9 innings. I have stopped at an average of 4.2. innings on my scorebook.
Really?
It's really been a tough start to the WBC for me personally, trying to keep score.
4.2, you pulled up really early.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, that last game, the early game we had here, and folks that didn't have a chance to be in front of a television set and watch it, it was really something to watch. I mean, we had all kinds of things to talk about, all kinds of activity, all kinds of permutations as to who would move on and who would be eliminated and who had to go to a tiebreaker based on the outcome. It took an extra innings run explosion by the Dominican Republic to survive Colombia and finish pool play with a perfect 3-0 record. The next order of business, who will join them at Petco Park? And if the U.S. wins this game, they get that chair. If Canada can upend the United States in this game, then all bets are off, and there's some math, and there's a tiebreaker formula and a play-in game tomorrow. Ernie Witt has been at the helm for just about all of Canada's significant international competition these last number of years. Saw the former Blue Jay a moment ago, and Wood is rung up on strikes.
Defensively for the U.S. team, pretty much the same when it comes to the infield. Yelich in left, Jones and Stanton. Arenado, Crawford, Kinsler, and Hosmer. In Buster Posey back behind the plate.
Two gone, bases empty for Atlanta Braves star Freddie Freeman. Freddie, as we've talked about throughout the tournament, playing for Team Canada, as both of his parents are from there. His mother, who passed away back in 2000 of cancer, grew up in Peterborough, Ontario, and his dad, Frederick, from Windsor. I know his dad was here the other night. I'm sure he's still on hand. Very proud of Freddie, representing the homeland, if you will, even though Freddie was born in the U.S.
Oh, man, hell of a catch.
Danny Duffy threatening to make quick work of the Canadiens. Strikeouts of Pete Orr and Eric Wood. And in front of Freddie Freeman, a ball and two strikes. Not quite the atmosphere here yet that there was for the early game.
That'll be a late arriving crowd because the first game took so long. It's been raining outside. They didn't open up gates really until just briefly before this game was getting ready to kick off.
Saw a shot of Freddie Freeman's dad a moment ago, who is in fact still around. How about that for a start for Danny Duffy? Strikes out the side. Just settling in here at Marlins Park. Canada 0, the U.S. coming to bat. Welcome back. Let's take a look at Jim Leland's U.S. lineup card for this one against Canada. Kinsler, Jones, and Yelich, Arenado, Hosmer, and Goldschmidt. Top six is the same as it was last night in the loss to the DR. Buster Posey back out there tonight. And Giancarlo Stanton and Brandon Crawford rounded out for the all-star studded U.S. lineup. Well, on the mound for Team Canada, making his second start of the tournament, the veteran right-hander Ryan Dempster, making his first appearance since 2013 when he pitched here on Thursday. He had a great time and didn't hang his head over his four earned on seven hits and two innings of work against the DR. In fact, he felt so good about it, he's back out there again tonight. Two balls and no strikes to Ian Kinsler. Make it 3-0 now. Ryan's last year in the big leagues, as we mentioned, 2013. The last appearance he had made came in the 2013 World Series before kicking the tires on a return and ultimately getting back out there Thursday night. He loses Kinsler on a four-pitch walk.
Well, for Dempster, besides, I still can't believe he's doing this. More props to him. Unfinished business, right? He did it earlier, had a blast. Maybe he'd like to get back out there one more time. Empty the tank, meaning he's got no organization he's tied to. Give him the best he can for Team Canada. And then try to be perfect. You got to keep it close because that's the only way that Canada, with a mathematical equation, could force a tiebreaker for Monday.
Leadoff hitter aboard for Adam Jones, who takes strike one. Adam Jones delivered the walk-off victory against Colombia in the first game for the U.S. here in Miami. Part of a two RBI opener for Adam. He sends a high drive out to shallow center here. Rene Tassone is under it. That's the first out for Dempster.
Well, defensively, O'Neill, we talked about the prospect that he is. Tassone, Romack, Wood, Mala, Orr, and Freeman. Gutierrez behind the plate. Ryan Dempster, I'm going to tell you something. After he's done with this performance, if he can brush his hair and use a fork, he's in better shape. I mean, it's impressive to think you've missed this kind of time and pitched twice in 3 days.
And come back and do it against another all-star lineup.
Ball one.
You know, he wasn't pitching against PS 91 from, Queens. He wasn't pitching against a high school team. He was pitching against the DR and now Team USA. the two biggest favorites in the tournament. A ball and no strikes, the count to Christian Yelich, who's had a great series and continues. That's the fourth hit for Yelich in this. It's 4 for 6, and that base hit puts runners in the corners. Miami Marlin feeling very comfortable here at home. Why not?
Yeah, low fastball finds the hole. Didn't get, you know, a lot of the barrel on it from a standpoint of a stinger, but he got it right where he needed to, and Kinsler didn't miss a beat going from first to third. And now Arenado, I think at this point he's probably more settled in to being less jumpy and less anxious. I just felt like the first couple at bats in this WBC he was really jumping out at the ball, trying to make something happen. Last couple at bats he squared him up.
Yeah, Arenado yet to enjoy the experience in terms of results. 0 for 8, as you saw a moment ago. Guy who's led baseball in RBIs the last two seasons.
That's totally understandable. That's why guys are down here trying to get ready, right? The spring training format, it takes guys 30, sometimes 40 at bats to feel the rhythm and the timing that they need to track pitches and certainly produce a great swing at the same time.
Ball and a strike to Nolan Arenado. You know, you mentioned something getting back to Dempster. You talked about the unfinished business that he may feel, and that in addition to the competitive juices flowing again. Remember that when Ryan Dempster retired after 2013, he walked away from an additional year of guaranteed money on his Red Sox contract.
2-1.
That was in excess of $14 million that he walked away from because he felt like it was time to go and he wanted to spend more time with his kids. So, knowing all that, it is understandable why he'd want to get out there and do this again, especially in a short burst like this tournament. 2-2 now. You usually don't leave until you're shown the door, until you're told it's time to go. Ryan walked away under his own terms, the same way he wanted to come back on his own terms. He's not fooling anybody. He's not claiming that this is the start of a major league comeback. He made it clear from the outset he wants to pitch in this event, and then that's it. Return to his life as an analyst and as a consultant and assistant to the general manager of the Cubs. Still 2-2 to Arenado.
And Harry Carey impersonations.
They're very good. But let's put it this way, they're very popular. Ryan's Harry Carey is an impersonation of Will Ferrell's Harry Carey, which is still good. Arenado hanging around.
Statcast powered by Amazon Web Services. It's going to show you Kinsler going from first to third. There's the max speed, first to third in 6.9 seconds. Got a good break once the ball is on the ground, once he saw it go through. That was all it took for Kinsler to get to third.
Kind of surprised that the lineup that we're watching was the lineup that we read to you. A couple of notable bench decisions tonight. Alex Bregman hasn't played in the event. Super utility guy. And Josh Harrison's still available down there and probably itching to get out there.
I would think at some point both of those guys will get in the game tonight.
Now there may be something we don't know, some word that came down from their clubs that maybe Jim Leland is keeping under his hat, and if that were to be the case, it's understandable. But I kind of agree with you, in the absence of that information, maybe tonight's the night we see him get out there. Arenado hooks a ball foul. Well, Jim Leland survived a tough one against Colombia. Endured a tough loss yesterday against the Dominican Republic, taking a 5-0 lead to the bottom half of the sixth. Forget about all that with a win here over Canada. The next 2-2, and a full count now to Nolan Arenado. The U.S. has benefited from two terrific starts so far in the tournament. Chris Archer in the opener, and Marcus Stroman last night was even that much better. Duffy trying to follow suit tonight. So far, so good. Retiring the Canadians in order in the first with a couple of strikeouts. Runner goes, and there's ball four to Arenado. So now Dempster's in a bases loaded jam, and he'll have to face the left-handed hitting Eric Hosmer.
Hosmer could ease the tension, if there is any, with a big hit here.
Denny Boucher out for a conversation. Team Canada's pitching coach the last time the event was run as well. So it's going to be up to Hosmer to try to cash in on this opportunity now with the bases loaded and one gone. Eric, a returnee to World Baseball Classic play. He went 5-for-25 in 2013 as a late fill-in for Mark Teixeira.
He's got power to all parts of the field. Good high ball hitter. He's going to take his hacks early in the count. Looking to drive the ball, and then with two strikes, he'll find a way to put it in play.
Big swing and a miss. Career bests in home runs and runs driven in 2016 in Kansas City for Eric Hosmer. Hit 266. The batting average dipped a bit. In fact, it was his lowest batting average finish in 4 years. But nobody's worried about this guy moving forward. A shot into left center field. Going to drive in at least one. Kinsler scores easily. Here's Yelich right behind him. A two-run double for Eric Hosmer, and the U.S. is on the board first.
Took that inner half fastball, and like I said, he can go to all parts of the field. He split the gap here. And has definitely eased the tension with a two-run already lead. U.S. looking to add on more.
There's Paul Goldschmidt now, 1-for-3, scored a couple of runs in the loss last night. Four-time All-Star playing in the World Baseball Classic for the first time in his career. Already third all-time in Diamondbacks home run history.
Ball.
Louis Gonzalez, Steve Finley, and just 13 behind Finley is Paul Goldschmidt. Trailing only the aforementioned Louis Gonzalez in RBIs. Arenado and Hosmer aboard, two runs in.
Ball three.
And three balls and no strikes to Goldschmidt with Buster Posey waiting on deck. Rio misses, and Goldschmidt's aboard on a four-pitch walk. Canada has its bullpen active Here comes Ernie Witt. That's going to be all for Ryan Dempster in this one. Well, the Canadians have to make the early move. Dempster removed after a third of an inning. He'll leave with the bases loaded and a couple of runners aboard. Andrew Albers threw the ball well earlier in the tournament, and they're going to rely on him to try to give him some length and keep things close. A pitching change early on tonight. We'll be right back. Or the third of an inning start, that is. A handful of appearances with last year's Twins, spent most of his time in Triple-A Rochester last year, where he was a 10-game winner in 21 starts.
Not overpowering, but he knows how to pitch. He finesses the strike zone with a variety of ways. He's going to have to wiggle out of a bases loaded jam here.
Ball one.
First offering home to Buster Posey misses wide. Posey caught the opener for Team USA on Friday and went 0 for 4 against Colombia. Sat last night as Jonathan Lucroy did the catching against the Dominican Republic. Albers pitched on Thursday, two scoreless innings against the Dominican, and he was the guy first called on to relieve Ryan Dempster on that night as well. Lee Dempster fared a bit better on Thursday, went two innings. And it's two balls and no strikes to Posey. Seven straight balls by Canada pitching. After the walk to Goldschmidt, now a 3-0 count to Buster Posey. Giancarlo Stanton waits next. The 3-0. Posey taking a strike.
Yeah, not a fun situation to come in the first inning. You're hoping to get a couple innings out of your starter, and versus 3-1, bases loaded to a pretty darn good hitter.
Who takes a strike, and it's a full count now. We talked a little bit about Andrew Albers on Thursday. One of the handful of Canadian players on this WBC roster with a lot of international experience. Pitched professionally in Korea in 2014. Here's his 3-2 to Posey. Back up the middle. A diving stop by Mallo. A great play. They get the out at first base. A run does score. It's 3-0 U.S. It could have been a lot worse. A fine play by the Canadian shortstop.
This ball wasn't hit really hard, but it was hit directly up the middle. So he had to range and dive to keep this ball from squirting into the outfield. Makes the play, and of course Pete Orr's got to do the same thing just in case Mallo does not come up with it. Buster Posey doesn't run extremely well, so he knew he had time to get up and make the throw to first.
Here's big Giancarlo Stanton, now really yet to get on track in the tournament in a couple of games, 1 for 6 with an extra base hit and an RBI.
Oh.
Left-handed batter Brandon Crawford waits next, and it's two balls and no strikes to Stanton. They want nothing to do with him here. In particular, noting the left-handed bat next. Understandably, they're going to put him aboard. an even easier decision after first base was vacated. So Stanton's walked. And Brandon Crawford will have a bases loaded opportunity now. Crawford had a big night yesterday in the loss, 2-for-4 with a couple of runs batted in, and in about the, I don't know, top of the sixth inning, we were talking about him being a player of the game candidate. It would all go away with the unanswered attack by the Dominicans yesterday. And they're come from behind win. The ninth batter to come to the plate this inning, and Crawford sends a bouncer to Pete Orr. Makes a fine sliding stop to cut off the rally at 3 runs. U.S. leaves them loaded, but they do damage. We go to the second. It's 3-0 Team USA. This World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network is presented by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And sponsored in part by Best Western Hotels and Resorts. Go get rewarded now at bestwestern.com. And by the new Alfa Romeo Giulia. Tyler O'Neill leads things off against Danny Duffy in the Canada second. O'Neill, Morneau, and Romac. And a 1-1 count to Tyler O'Neill.
Duffy had a rather lengthy rest after the top of the first.
Yeah, he watched his mates bat around, get him 3 runs of support. He worked through the side efficiently to start his night as O'Neill sends a fly ball into very shallow center. Jones has enough time to get there for the first out.
Well, in the first inning, you couldn't be any sharper than Danny Duffy was. He basically said, "You sit down. You, you're next." And the good 3 in a row.
Talk about the strikeouts per nine, a new career best for him, and one of the best numbers among left-handers last year in baseball. Here's the former MVP Justin Morneau now. Justin's had kind of a rough go of it so far in the World Baseball Classic, 0-for-7. But even by the admission of his manager, Ernie Witt, there's a little rust there. Justin's not in camp with the team, so he does not have the benefit of having reported in mid-February. He's still in shape. He's still been working out. He has a desire to play again this year. Been a terrific player over his 14-year career, a batting title in Denver in 2014. On the ground at first, sharply hit for Hosmer, but no problem for Eric. And that's out number two.
Yeah, he would be basically looking to only be in the American League if somebody were to pick him up, primarily as a DH. And who knows, you keep yourself in the shouts here from a lot of people. You never know what the team needs down the stretch or even early on with injuries.
Yeah, there are a lot of those guys still out there. I think Ryan Howard is still on sign. Here's Jamie Romac now with two out and the base is empty.
All one.
Even a guy who had a productive 2016, somebody like Pedro Alvarez, he had to return to his previous employer on a minor league deal. It's getting kind of late in the game for those opportunities. 1-1. There is a late game in World Baseball Classic play tonight, and that's Mexico and Venezuela. Mexico's winless. If Venezuela wins, they're in. Simple as that. They'll join Puerto Rico, who finished pool play 3-0. But if Mexico can figure out a way to beat Venezuela, then there will be three teams tied at 1-2, and they'll have to go through the same kind of tiebreaker formula dance that we've tried our best to explain here in Miami.
It's not different in a different country.
No, there's no exchange.
No
exchange rate.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Good to go. Good to know.
It's a good question, though. Romack locked up there. Two balls and two strikes on a ball right on the corner.
He was even going.
Yeah. Jamie Romack wearing a mic for us tonight on the field.
That's the thing with these lineups, as deep as they are, like, you have to answer to somebody. You know, at some point, you got to throw it over the pot.
You got that right. I mean, just ask anybody that's pitched to the Dominican lineup. Full count now, three balls and two strikes. 13 seasons in the minors. Jamie played in Japan last year. We talked about all the Canadian players that have international experience. Back and foul near us.
Oh, boy. I was looking at my monitor.
Were you really?
I thought that was close.
I usually look to you to save us. Yeah, we're not exactly right down there at ground level here at Marlins Park either. Full count, three balls and two strikes to Jamie Romack. I still remember vividly what you would probably identify as one of the most amazing feats of human skill that you've ever seen, because I felt the same way when we were in Boston about 5-6 years ago.
Yep.
Way up. I mean, we're way up. And Dustin Pedroia picked up the ball with a fungo bat from about, I don't know, the pitcher's mound, and said, he pointed at you and said, "Hey, Smoltzy," and he hit it to you through a window right into your hands.
And it's not a very big window at,
no,
at Fenway.
Romack needs another bat, and he'll try it again on 3-2.
What was the most impressive part, me catching it or him hitting it in the window?
They were both impressive for my money. Caught the head of the bat, and that's a souvenir. But he picked it up and did it on the first try like he'd done it a million times before. Dustin Pedroia has played in this event, has he not?
Yes, I'm pretty sure. I thought I saw him watching.
About four strikeouts in two innings for Danny Duffy. Welcome back to this World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network, presented by GEICO, with John Smoltz and J.P. Morosi, Matt Vasgersian. Headed to San Diego tomorrow, unless a play-in game is necessary. On that occasion, we'd stay and bring that to you tomorrow. We'll play in San Diego. Beautiful Petco Park starts on Tuesday evening, and we're looking forward to the next leg of the tournament. Meanwhile, 3-0 USA. The Americans win this one, and they'll join the Dominican Republic in advancing to San Diego. A ball and a strike to Ian Kinsler from Andrew Albers. Kinsler, Jones, and Yelich, top of the order here in the last of the second. U.S. bats around in the first.
See, he does enough with his changeup, curveball, and fastball to make his fastball look a little sneakier fast. That changeup right there, you see it turn over, 77.
Flare out to right, and it hangs up in enough time for Romack to run down. I know Adam Jones is looking forward to going back to San Diego, his hometown. Load up the pass list.
When he's not watching baseball.
That's right. Christian Yelich waits on deck. Boy, he sure enjoyed the stay at home. Christian has singled and scored tonight. 4 for 6 in the tournament so far. And Jones has a base hit to left. Say hello to J.P. Morosi once again tonight. J.P. Christian Yelich, a Southern California kid who had football in the blood, but it would appear he made the right choice to play baseball.
He certainly did, Matt. And his mother, Alicia, has been here in Miami watching the games this weekend. His brother, Cameron's been following from an ocean away. Cameron is a United States Marine. He's stationed in Hawaii right now with one more deployment coming up, certainly following from afar. And Christian has told me his brother's service in the military has certainly lent a lot of perspective to now representing Team USA in the WBC.
Yeah, boy, it seems like the Marlins always have a guy who has a military tie-in or a military family, and as a result is very active with the extended military community. I know Chris Coughlin, a former Rookie of the Year with the Marlins, he shares that in common with Christian Yelich. There's a strike, and it's 0-2. We talked about the football in Christian's blood. Has an uncle that won a couple of Rose Bowls as a lineman at UCLA back in the 80s. And more notably, his great grandfather was Fred Gerkel. And if Fred Gerkel's name doesn't ring a bell, he was a halfback for the Cleveland / Los Angeles Rams. His accomplishment will sound familiar. He's the man credited with designing the football helmet. He was an art major at the University of Utah, and he pioneered the craft of a picture or a logo on a helmet. In fact, he invented the Rams logo, the yellow horns on the blue background that they still wear today.
That will be forever locked in my memory bank. I like that.
Oh, good. I like that. That's something that'll stick with you. There's another hit for him. Jones wraps around. Runners at the corners with one away. And bottle Christian Yelich. He is just red hot. Back one out singles, and the U.S. is in business again. Nolan Arenado the batter now. I know Christian Yelich is going to want to just keep things the same for the next couple of days. I mean, he has been as productive a hitter as we've seen in the tournament, JP.
He has, Matt. And how about this? Check out this combination. Yelich, Arenado. They were teammates on a travel ball team.
And Nolan Arenado finally gets into the act. First pitch, 3-run Johnson. Oh, you knew that was coming. He had been conspicuously quiet for 2 days.
Last couple of bats were getting better. You could just see the timing early on, a little jumpy, as I talked about. Took an off speed pitch right there, almost on the front side of his. When his foot hit the ground, he absolutely crushes this ball. That's got to feel good. You don't worry about spring training if you go 0 for 13. You really don't. But in this format, you don't want to go 0 for 13. 0 for 10. You want to get check yourself in. See how he gets right down through it, stays back, head down. Very strong.
Eric Hosmer now. And he gets one into the corner. Some lefty lefty success for Hosmer. Single, single, homer, double with one out here in the second. It all comes full circle there, JP.
It does. And again, as I was mentioning before the home run, Yelich and Arenado were teammates on a travel ball team on Southern California, coached by the late Mike Spires. Again, they were travel ball teammates as kids, and now back-to-back hits for Team USA.
So both of them enjoying a nice night. And so far it had only been to this date rather to this point it had only been Yelich enjoying the circumstance. Paul Goldschmidt with a fly ball into center field. Tassoni's got it. That's the second out of the inning.
I find what's most interesting besides these guys getting a chance to play together when they leave here they'll all play against each other for the most part. They won't mind sharing information with each other position players about hitting talking about hitting picking each other's brains. That part is really unique experience. Getting a chance to play with somebody you admired or always wondered what that person was like.
There's Buster Posey once again. He knocked in a run with a fielder's choice play in the first. To the count to Buster Posey. There are, and I don't like the term, there are mercy rules in World Baseball Classic play.
What would you call it if you don't like that term?
I don't know. What do you call it? I mean, mercy rule, slaughter rule. It's
termination factor.
Termination rules. Early termination.
Early termination.
Is that what we call it officially? Early termination rules. Yes, there it is. After five innings, if a team leads by 15, it's a wrap. And then after seven, if a team leads by 10, it's an official game. Oh, and two, the count to Buster Posey.
All inside.
I mean, we're not there yet. We're just letting you know the rules, folks. Buster checked it. It's 2-2. There is a right hander up in the Canada bullpen. Quite sure Ernie Wood would like to get through this second inning with Albers. Stanton next, two balls and two strikes to Buster Posey. Base hit to left. Hosmer's going to be waved around. The throw is offline. 7-0 U.S. And Posey will take an extra base on the errant throw to the plate.
Would pitch the next inning if he doesn't come in this inning to finish it off.
Now Albers has to face Giancarlo Stanton, who he walked in the first.
Ball one.
And Stanton takes 1-0. Seven nothing U.S. Stanton sends a ground ball to Mallo, and not before the U.S. can do some big time adding on. One scheduled game tomorrow in World Baseball Classic play, and it's at 6 a.m. Eastern. The Netherlands taking on Israel, undefeated Israel, might I add. And then if the tiebreaker games are needed from here in Miami or from Jalisco, Mexico, those will also be played tomorrow. And again, there's a game coming up later on tonight from Jalisco that means quite a lot, actually. Mexico and Venezuela, and if Venezuela can win, they're in. They're in the same situation the U.S. is in here. United States with a 7-0 lead on Canada, top half of the third for Rene Tassoni. As Canada tries to solve Danny Duffy, who has been great so far through two innings, four strikeouts.
Yeah, fastball looks really fresh. Change up and his slider just as good.
We talked about how the designated pitchers pool has changed for Team USA should they advance to San Diego. A called strike three. Five strikeouts for Danny Duffy tonight.
That's where Posey wanted it.
Mark Melancon and Jeff Samardzija are now available on that additional roster, if you will, in the additional pitchers pool for the next round. It was thought that some additional pitching help was available. Michael Fulmer, notably, he is no longer eligible or no longer a part of that plan. Some pretty good options there, though, and a couple of San Francisco Giants will be close by, let's face it, in the Cactus League in Scottsdale. A ball and a strike to George Gutierrez, a swing and a miss. JP, am I missing anybody in that designated pitchers pool?
Well, Matt, one thought to keep in mind is that Tanner Roark is probably the one guy we can say confidently will probably come off the roster following this round. The only other option in one of those spots that is changeable, if you will, after the first round is Drew Smyly. Now, Smyly has not yet pitched in this tournament. He is one option to start the first game in San Diego or tomorrow night, depending on the circumstances.
Yeah, that's a pretty good card to play as well. Jim Leland must feel good about having Drew Smyly available for him. A ball and two strikes to George Gutierrez. Puts it in play at the very least. A chance for Crawford, and that's out number two. Well, the strikeout's been the big weapon for Danny Duffy tonight. Five of them. He's no stranger to big strikeout games. Let's take you back to August 1st of last season at Tropicana Field. Duffy carried a no-hitter through seven, dominated Tampa Bay en route to a 3-0 win, finished with a one-hit franchise record, 16 strikeouts. 35 swings and misses in that game, and that tied Clayton Kershaw for the most in a single game over the past 2 years.
Well, when you're on, you just feel like you can throw anything off of your fastball. And again, fastball command and velocity for him is such a rare thing for a left-handed starter to be able to command the fastball and then throw that changeup slider combination. And in all those quick highlights we saw, the ball never stayed in the middle of the strike zone. Rarified air when you feel like that.
Danny Duffy's really had to earn his keep as a staff ace too. I mean, nothing taken for granted. He had kicked around for some years on the AAA shuttle. Again, as we mentioned, as recently as last year, started the season in the bullpen.
Well, and he said it took him a while. He really kind of didn't embrace starting. He was really enjoying the bullpen and the mindset of coming out of the bullpen. It took a little more to adapt to the rotation.
2-2 to Jonathan Mollo. After years of kind of, you know, teasing Royals fans and people getting excited about Danny Duffy, he had a breakthrough year of sorts in 2014, 9-12 and a 2.53 ERA, and then regressed in 2015. I think he's proven he's here to stay. Into right and down in front of Stanton for Canada's first base hit of the evening. First base hit, first base runner against Danny Duffy.
Adam Jones looking at him like, how in the world did you get this little in-between hop that looked like it was going to get by him? And he puts the glove down and makes a nice little snag, keeps him from going to second. play there.
First pitch to Pete Orr, a base hit back up the middle, first and second with two away. Back to back two out singles for Canada here in the third. Duffy still at just 47 pitches. Again, the hard cap in this round is 65. No cause for concern for Jim Leland, though the back-to-back singles does get some bullpen activity started. Wood was a strikeout victim in the first. And takes a strike here. Michael Gibbons up for Team USA. I would imagine anxious to get back out there after allowing a couple of runs against Colombia in his opener.
Yeah, after striking out the first two and making them look really silly.
To the count to Eric Wood. Drafted as a pitcher back in 2011 by the Oakland A's.
What's up? 1-2.
What a great pitch. That is a pitch that isn't utilized by a lot of people. It's a tough pitch unless you practice it. That's the high fastball. You do so much after you establish the eyesight of the hitter up here, right? You wanted to go for it. A lot of hitters think they can hit that pitch. It's very difficult. Especially with the velocity and angle he throws to get on top of that pitch.
Got him swinging. Six strikeouts for Danny Duffy through three scoreless on MLB Network. A 7-0 lead for Team U.S. as they open the last of the third with Brandon Crawford, then top of the order Kinsler and Jones, doing so against a new pitcher on the mound for Canada, right-hander Scott Richmond.
Richmond trying to establish something for the Canadian team. It's been a rough start. Hitters are in rhythm. I would look for Jim Leland here. A few more innings from these guys and start looking maybe. Putting in a couple guys who haven't played.
Might be curious about that line we just showed you for Richmond. His 2016 numbers with the EDA Rhinos. Crawford sends a ball to deep center and off the baggie. Crawford continuing a great tournament with a leadoff double here in the third. Finish the thought on Richmond, the EDA Rhinos, the Chinese Professional Baseball League. He'll have to deal with a runner in scoring position here.
Curveball over the middle of the plate. Crawford looked like he thought that one was gone. He hit it as far as you can hit it. 407 to center field. A little bit towards the right center.
Top of the order, Ian Kinsler now. He's walked and scored tonight. And a breaking ball starts him with a strike. Scott Richmond's actually a great story. Spent seven seasons in the minors and went to a high school that did not offer baseball. So he played in amateur summer leagues throughout Western Canada and supported himself by working on the docks in Vancouver. Went to school at Oklahoma State. Left there undrafted. I mean, he was 25 years old at the time. Signed with a Northern League team, independent, unaffiliated Northern League baseball, the Edmonton Cracker Cats. What, pray tell, is on the cap of the Cracker Cats?
1-2.
Why should I have known that J.P. Morosi would know what's on the cap? What is on the cap of the Cracker Cats, J.P.?
That question, Matt, I'm not sure that I can answer, but I can tell you a bit more about Scott Richmond.
Okay, I'd love to hear it.
Very good. Scott actually pitched, so as you mentioned, independent ball in Canada, independent ball in the U.S., and 2 years ago, at this time, Matt, he was interviewing to really start working in real estate. He thought it was time to hang him up for baseball, but he spoke with Greg Hamilton, Baseball Canada's GM, and wanted to pitch one last time for Canada on home soil in the Pan Am Games. Well, he did that, and that became the Premier 12 in Taiwan back in the fall of 2015. And he pitched so well there, Matt, that that was where the Rhinos found him, and he's been in Taiwan now for last season and this one.
Really is a great story. There's a high fly ball on the left as Malo yields to O'Neill for route number one. I mean, you've got to love baseball. First of all, to pitch as an amateur when you're in high school, despite the fact that your high school doesn't even offer a team, and then travel the country as Richmond has just to stay out there, and doing so at let's face it, an advanced age. He's 37 years old. Here's Adam Jones now.
Especially the fact today we look for guys who throw 95 and above.
Ball one.
Who among us is Googling right now the Cracker Cats? JP doesn't have an answer on that within the next inning or so. I'm going to be wildly disappointed. The ball and a strike to count to Adam Jones with Christian Yelich waiting on deck. He has been the U.S.'s hottest hitter the last couple of nights.
Yeah, he quickly went into the three spot after that pinch hit double, just being locked in.
Ball and two strikes to Adam Jones. You know, it's not just the good tournament that Yelich has had, it's the fact that all the numbers are trending as such that he's on the verge of major league stardom. Had such a good year last year, won a Silver Slugger with a 298 average and 21 home runs, 98 driven in. He's the only member of the starting lineup so far that has not made an all-star team. But that and perhaps many others are coming.
I mean, it's rare when you see players. I mean, I guess you could almost always think, well, everybody that swings the bat has a chance to win a batting title. Not exactly, but I've heard this from a lot of people saying this kid's going to win a batting title. And how that translates to an early sign seeing of him to in only a short time becoming one of those best hitters in the, not only in this ball club but in the league. And I could see it. I could see that he could win a batting title someday.
Ball and two strikes to the five-time All-Star Adam Jones, who has a hit and a run scored tonight. Chopper to third. Wood backs up on it and has Jones at first. The Crawford still sitting at second after his leadoff double. We'll see if the aforementioned Mr. Yelich can drive him in. Those numbers will make a manager feel pretty smart.
Let's get it done.
Ball.
Breaking ball starts Yelich with the ball 1-0. Again, Mexico and Venezuela later on tonight from Jalisco. If the star-studded Venezuela team wins, they join Puerto Rico in advancing in the tournament.
Ball
knocking out pesky Italy. Boy, I tell you what, first two games they played 11-10. They ran into a tough one today. Their only hope is Mexico wins.
Yeah, they'll get into a tiebreaker formula if Mexico does beat Venezuela tonight, and we'll have that one live for you at 10 Eastern. Or whenever this one ends, if we go long. Puerto Rico gets through Pool D at a perfect 3-0. The runners up in the 2013 World Baseball Classic, and then again, if Mexico wins, they'll be 3-1-2 teams. And the tiebreaker formulas will kick in.
Up.
Two balls and two strikes, the count to Yelich. Nolan Arenado waits next. He slugged the big three-run home run in the second. Richmond's 2-2. I still think Japan is going to be a tough out in this thing.
They do all the things you need to do to win baseball games.
Two balls and two strikes to Jones, or rather to Yelich, it remains. And there's a bouncing ball to first for Freeman to retire the side without a score. First time the Americans have been turned away scoreless tonight. Three innings in the books, 7-0 U.S. Welcome back to this World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network, presented by GEICO. Alongside John Smoltz and J.P. Morosi, Matt Vasgersian back at Marlins Park. 36,000 plus in the opener. A nice crowd here for the nightcap and a 7-0 U.S. lead. Freddie Freeman opening things in the fourth with a ground ball to the right side of the infield, and Danny Duffy just keeps rolling along. Between innings, J.P. Morosi had a chance to visit with one of the members of the U.S. coaching staff, Tiger great Alan Trammell.
Here with Al Trammell. Alan, you've played in the World Series before. How about this atmosphere here?
Well, it's very special. Last night was, as the boys were talking about, very much like a playoff or World Series atmosphere. And, you know, we come out on the short end, but it's been a great tournament. Hats off to Columbia and everybody here. And hopefully we advance to San Diego.
You're a Hall of Famer in my mind, Tram. As I've said before, looking at these young players, who stands out to you right now?
Well, you know, I'm a middle infield guy, and Brandon Crawford is, I mean, I know a lot of people around know about him, but more should. This guy is a tremendous, not only defensively, but clutch hitting and all around. Nolan Arenado, they're all good, but again, my heart's always in the middle of the infield.
Tram, thanks so much.
My pleasure.
Yeah, Alan Trammell wants to get back to San Diego. Probably more than any of the players, because he liked to sleep in his own bed for a little while.
Yeah.
that's been home for Alan for boy, just about all of his adult life, despite the time in Detroit.
Well, you're speaking my language there. I grew up watching Alan Trammell, Lou Whitaker, Tom Brookins, all the guys that made Detroit and the World Series in 84 pretty special.
Pitch to Tyler O'Neill, misses upstairs. Two balls and two strikes. I think because Hall of Fame voting and the considerations for that award are changing all the time. I think there'll probably be a new generation of voters or potential voters that will re-examine his case. O'Neill takes a called strike three, and there are two gone. He's a Hall of Famer for me as well. Seven strikeouts for Danny Duffy, guy who gets most of them swinging, and four of those seven tonight have been of the called variety. That matches his high count in that capacity all of last year.
It's
Justin Morneau now, who takes a ball in.
As this thing prolongs, I don't know who's staying who's being added. Sure would like to see him stick around.
Stick around, yeah. Him and Stroman and Archer. I mean, the starts that the U.S. squad has gotten have been terrific. This will be pitch number 60 on its way from Duffy, so almost a certainty that this is his final hitter. A ball and two strikes to Justin Morneau. Sitting on 7 strikeouts. Still the ball and two strikes. Royal staff's going to look a little bit different in parts. Jason Hamill brought aboard. But Danny Duffy remains the anchor.
No! Wedge!
Morneau checks the swing and it's 2-2. The loss of Yordano Ventura is something that nobody can really not only wrap their heads around from a human standpoint, but quantify in baseball terms yet. I mean, he was your 1A if Duffy was your 1. Finding a way to piece those innings together through the free agent market. Two to Morneau, wrapped out to second base. 4 scoreless innings by Danny Duffy, whose night is through.
Baseball plus all the news that's central to the game. Look, this is one of the best shows. I can tell you from experience, it's presented by Hyundai.
Nolan Arenado making a bid for a second home run tonight. It'll fall short, one away.
And it is returning Monday, April 3rd on MLB Network. I knew that was awkward for you to do that, so I took the burden off of it. And people, join in. Join in MLB Network and MLB Central.
Well, thanks for the endorsements, Mulsey. We love when you're on the show.
I love it. You can sit on the couch.
Tired couch. We've learned to embrace it. Here's Eric Hosmer now with one away. Hosmer's had a nice night, a pair of doubles, 2 runs batted in and a run scored. We understand that J.P. Morosi is in the stands with a special guest.
Yes, Matt, I'm here with one of the proudest fans on hand at Marlins Park this evening, Alicia Yelich, the mother of Christian Yelich, and Colin Yelich, a catcher in the Marlins system, and Cameron Yelich, a U.S. Marine. Alicia, how proud are you right now?
Extremely proud. Really, really proud. Can't get any prouder. It's been a great, great couple of days here in Miami.
So Christian told me yesterday he got to the clubhouse and saw his name batting 3rd in the lineup for Team USA. He said he was speechless. He was so humble. Is that a surprise to you?
No, he is really humble. I was speechless. I was like, wow, he's getting to start a game today.
Oh, my.
So it was awesome to see his name up on the board yesterday.
And as well, Alicia, to hear how warmly and lovingly Christian speaks about Cameron and his service to our country, how does that make you feel?
It brings tears to my eyes, really. They're all so supportive of each other. It's really nice to see.
So how much, as Christian being the oldest, how easily or how much of a challenge is it for him to stay in touch with his brothers during the course of the baseball season?
Oh, they're always in touch. They're always texting. He and Cameron text a lot. Funny jokes. Strom on the team who pitched yesterday was Cameron's favorite player. So they were texting about that yesterday before the game.
Of course, last summer, one of the great things we saw in Major League Baseball last year was the Fort Bragg game. And of course, Christian got a chance to play in it. Cameron, of course, was watching from afar. What were your emotions that week?
Well, we're obviously a military family, and we support the military, all branches. And it was just a proud moment to see him there on the military base, mentioning his brother and his brother being proud of him for being there, me being proud for him representing, and being proud for Cameron, the Marine. And it was a good moment. They were texting.
No.
And if this lead holds, if the lead holds up, of course, Alicia, you'll be back home in Southern California watching Team USA again in a couple days.
Yes, definitely. We'll be there every game, San Diego, and hopefully we end up in LA.
Alicia, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Matt, back to you.
Yeah, JP, great stuff. That'll be, those will be home games for the Yelich family, Southern Californians. Buster Posey with a drive out to center field. Some loud outs here, but three outs nonetheless. And the U.S. is turned away for a second straight inning. We played four complete tonight, still 7-0 Team USA. This copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Office of the Commissioner of Baseball, may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. The accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent. 7-0 lead for the Americans as they turn it over on the mound. Danny Duffy was terrific tonight through four innings. And he hands the ball to Baltimore right-hander Michael Gibbons, 66 appearances with last year's O's. And he's trying to erase the taste of his WBC debut.
1-1.
In which he allowed a run on four hits. In which he allowed two runs, rather, on three hits on Friday night against Columbia. A strike to Jamie Romack. It's 1-2.
Gibbons still has nasty stuff. You see the angle. You don't see that kind of action from a low three quarters to sidearm delivery.
2-2.
Romack, Tashani, and Kataris. Two balls and two strikes.
Are a huge part of the bullpen for the Orioles and their success last year. Of course, their closer is one of the best.
3-2.
But they got to get to a closer because their starters didn't eat up a lot of innings, so that bullpen had a lot of work to do, and they did it well.
Full count, three balls and two strikes, and a big swing and a miss.
Well, Danny Duffy was pretty good, and StatCast powered by Amazon Web Services is going to explain the deal here. He had a fastball that exploded. He gave him fits all night. You see the velocity, you see the spin rate on it. It didn't matter right-handed or left-handed, it was up there. It's pretty much the same story. That's an exploding fastball. Now that changeup you saw right there, that's much more difficult for the hitters to pick up after seeing a fastball. And I talked about it earlier in the first game about the difference of velocity versus late life. Danny Duffy has late life. You won't see 97, 98 per se, but you're going to see the hitters react to it like it was 97 or 98.
Rene Tassoni has been a strikeout victim tonight. Duffy was outstanding tonight. The whole starting staff for the U.S. has been great. Three terrific starts. Archer, Stroman, and Duffy in particular this evening. They've just gotten better and better. One hopper. Hosmer playing hacky sack and wins the race to the base.
Yeah, they haven't given up an earned run.
12 2/3 of scoreless baseball as Tyler Clifford gets hot in the bullpen.
There you have it.
I mean, Marcus Stroman was really super impressive yesterday considering the lineup he had to face as well. Two quick outs here for Michael Gibbons, and now it's George Kataris.
Oh.
George Kataris, another one of the many Canadians with a lot of international baseball experience, in addition to his time in the big leagues. He represented Greece in the 2004 Olympics in Athens. when an entire baseball complex was constructed in a city that doesn't play baseball anywhere ever. And by the way, that entire complex was taken down about 4 years later. Kind of a shame.
Yeah.
Two balls and two strikes to Gutierrez. Josh Harrison does not look like he's about to get into the ballgame imminently.
It's not diminishing his fun.
No, not a bit. He's had a blast the last few nights. I want to see a lineup with Josh Harrison, with Alex Bregman, two super utility pieces. I mean, to call those guys utility players is not totally giving you the right read, because they are everyday major league players that just happen to be able to play everywhere on the field. And Gutierrez has a base hit. Extends for the shortstop, Jonathan Mallo. Earlier today here in Pool C, the Dominican Republic was able to survive Colombia in a game in which the final score doesn't really represent how closely played and how nervous the DR may have been. The upstart Colombian team, a home run in the eighth. They were able to tie it at three, get it to extra innings. And at that point, the Dominican lineup just went nuts.
Yeah, but they had them. They had them in the ninth inning. It's a fraction of a play, and the ball's hit a little bit further, slide a little bit different. This whole scenario plays out much different.
Jose Bautista throws out what would have been the winning run in the last of the ninth. Send the game to extra innings when in the 11th the Dominican team got seven runs, and they finish off a perfect 3-0 pool round, advancing to San Diego. If the U.S. can hang on here and they're on top 7-0 in the middle innings, they will join the Dominican Republic. This is what happened in the ninth inning today in our first game. Jose Bautista, not known for his arm, was able to get it up on the throw, and a great play on the receiving end by Wellington Castillo kept the game tied for extra innings.
You know, runners on first and third, tough read for the base runner at third. He wants to get the biggest jump he can on anything on the ground, which creates a big lead. But then when the ball's hit, you react, and he races back to the bag to tag, as we saw there. And just that fraction of a difference,
2-2,
can make the difference in whether you're safe or out.
Two balls and two strikes. They count to Jonathan Mallo.
That's the point I'm making. As compared to a high fly ball where all you know you're going to do is tag, that was a line drive.
Swing and a miss finishes the inning. Michael Gibbons with a scoreless fifth, on to inning number six and a 7-0 U.S. lead. This World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network is brought to you by the Puerto Rico Tourism Company. Visit seapuertorico.com to plan your trip today. And by Lexus, experience the thrill of the Lexus Command Performance Sales Event now through March 31st. See your Lexus dealer. And by the DQ $5 Lunch, now served all day, every day. New pitcher for Canada, left-hander Kevin Chapman takes over here in the sixth. He'll start against Giancarlo Stanton. Stanton, Crawford, and Kinsler here for the Americans' last half of the fifth. Chapman's numbers last year with AAA Fresno, for the last number of years an Astros affiliate, after a long affiliation with the Giants. Top tank foul, as only he can.
Chapman's got the slider you just saw there and a curveball at 73 miles an hour. But his changeup is a little bit firmer. Good action on the pitch. A little three quarter, sometimes slings it type action.
Twos.
Two balls and two strikes. We know that Giancarlo can hit him a long way. May of 2012. Can't get enough of this one. Rockies and Marlins right here. Bases loaded in the fourth. A grand slam off Jamie Moyer that broke a panel in the scoreboard. Was in the ballpark's first year. What a way to open the joint. Chapman strikes him out here. One gone.
One pitch he's been going after early on. You can get him up the stairs above the hands. See to a hitter, he thinks I'm going to get on top of that. And very difficult to do.
2012 was before the StatCast era, but using the old conventional math before StatCast, it was an estimated 462 feet. There's Brandon Crawford now. He's doubled tonight. 4 for 9 in the series. You know this as well as anybody because I know you pay attention to this kind of thing. But back in the day, way before StatCast and before a lot of the technology that preceded it, home run distance was simply a matter of a chart that probably lived in the scoreboard room. That one of the longtime stadium employees that usually ran in the scoreboard operation would he'd look at where the ball landed and he'd tell you how far it was hit. There wasn't a lot of technology involved. So if it hit that seat in row F in section 102 or whatever, it went 395 feet, whatever the number was. Not exactly scientific.
That makes me feel better about getting chipped back in the day at 428 feet and the leading home run distance would get a computer, you know, donated in your name. And they gave it to Dale Murphy because supposedly he hit it farther than
that. Actually, you hit a home run that was one of the longest of the year and
yep.
You were in the running for a computer, huh?
Yep.
He hits him hard. Highest exit velo since 2015.
Ball down.
Kind of represents Team USA in that category. You know, last year, the four highest average exit velocities in baseball, three of those belong to members of Team Dominican Republic. Stanton can match those guys mile for mile.
See, I've been looking for, and I'm sure, you know, at some point we'll come up with it analytically. I want the formula of taking exit velocity, but then computing the penalty for not hitting the ball via a strikeout. And I want to know who the overall best hitter is, combining the ability to put it in play with good velocity, but also not striking out a bunch.
So you want contact and exit velocity.
Yes.
As Crawford grounds to second. Nice play by Pete Orr for out number two.
And the way that you would figure out, and I'm not just talking about a guy who slaps it or weak contact, but there's got to be some value in being able to put the ball in play a little bit more than just hitting it hard when you do put it in play.
Yeah, I would agree. I think even advocates of exit velocity as a meaningful stat have to concede that. If you make contact one out of every 10 plate appearances, but you hit it 100 miles an hour when you make contact, you're not helping anybody. Here's Ian Kinsler now. Look, you know the way this is going. We want to explain everything with numbers now, even though those numbers sometimes are applied in the wrong spots. Two balls and no strikes to Kinsler.
I mean, I guess the counter argument for that, the equivalent would be a guy throws 102 miles an hour on every pitch, but his ERA is 6.5. It's nice to see, but come on, you know.
It's a great example.
Reno.
Well, when exit velocity was born, I think we all became so obsessed with hit velocity that we didn't really contemplate it's a more meaningful stat for the pitcher. So a guy who gives up weak contact like Dallas Keuchel 2 years ago, that's more meaningful than how hard a guy hits the ball. On average, what's happening against that pitcher? I think that's the best application of exit velocity. Kinsler draws the walk. He's aboard with two gone now, and Adam Jones will dig back in. Jones has a hit and a run scored tonight. I think enough time has passed to judge the trade that sent Adam Jones from Seattle to Baltimore.
Ball.
I think so.
I think so too. And I think it was a really good one for Baltimore. What seems like an eternity to go. Eric Bedard sent to Seattle in exchange for a then young and then not as well known Adam Jones. Christian Yelich waiting on deck. Two out, base runner aboard. That's Kinsler, who drew the walk. That one gets past Kataris, and Kinsler scurries down to second. Mexico and Venezuela coming up later tonight at 10 Eastern. We'll take you there as soon as this one is done. That's Luis Mendoza and Yusmeiro Petit on the mound for Venezuela. Venezuela wins. They are headed to San Diego. Two balls and two strikes. It's turning into a very interesting looking bracket there. The U.S. takes care of business here. The U.S., the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, and Venezuela. They can beat Mexico tonight. Sharply hit ground ball to third. Woods got it. And the Americans are turned away in the fifth. We've played five complete tonight. Still a 7-0 U.S. lead. Reminder, follow every pitch of this year's World Baseball Classic live with the MLB.com at-bat mobile app. Stay connected to the best players in the game all spring and all season long. Your number one app for live baseball. And join Major League Baseball, the new era, as we celebrate opening day. Be sure to wear your cap on April 3rd and share a photo on social media using the hashtag CapsOn. And tune into all the opening day action on April 3rd on ESPN, MLB Network, and MLB.com. Tyler Clippard, the new pitcher for Team USA, on here in the sixth to face Pete Orr, the top of the order for Canada.
There's the numbers on the year. Again, a tremendous changeup, fastball. He'll throw a slider and a curveball, but fastball, changeup. He loves that changeup in pressure situations.
Starting pitching for the U.S. has been outstanding. Chris Archer in the opener. Marcus Stroman last night and Danny Duffy tonight. He's standing by with JP.
Thanks, Matt, here with Long Polk, California's own Danny Duffy. Now, Danny, you had a chance to pitch Team USA back to your home state tonight. What have been your emotions on this day?
Oh, it's been a lot of fun. And I've been saying all along, any chance you get to wear these letters on your chest is an honor. And, you know, you got to take it by storm and just enjoy it, you know, every second.
So you're used to certainly pitching in front of a very good defensive team in KC. How about these gloves behind you?
It's unreal. I mean, you look around and it's just all these guys are just superstars and you got to pinch yourself playing with them. It's been a lot of fun. I mean, Kinsler is an absolute stud. All these guys, I could go on forever about them, but, you know, it's been a lot of fun getting to know these guys and, you know, you see them from afar, but playing with them is a huge honor.
So there's a little conversation before this tournament about the starters Team USA didn't have. Well, the ones they do have, shutout, shutout, shutout. How much have Archer, Stroman, and now you fed off each other?
I mean, we really have a whole lot. I mean, the energy in these kinds of games are different than regular season. Feels like a playoff atmosphere, and you want to try to hype each other up, but not to get it, you know, out of control. But, you know, it's been fun. I've really enjoyed being on the same staff as these guys, and, you know, it's just been great. I know, you know, the WBC, sometimes people don't come for health reasons or for, you know, well, they want to make sure that they're with their team, and that's all good and fine, but if you're healthy, you get the invite, you can't, you know, you got to bat an eye at it at least.
Talking about your World Series experience, Danny, you've pitched in it twice. How has the atmosphere this weekend compared to that?
I tell you what, me and Haas looked at each other yesterday, and that was the loudest we've ever heard any game ever. And, you know, that doesn't take anything away from Kansas City. It was, you know, rambunctious. I mean, that's probably the best word. And it was cool. It was a different environment. It was a different style of play. It was a different style of a fan base. And, you know, we had a blast. It was a heck of a game.
You know, it's only a short time, Danny, that you can be together before the game start. But have you noticed moments where there's been some chemistry developing now with this group?
Yeah, I mean, from the jump, when we got into the clubhouse together, a lot of us have known each other from, you know, playing, you know, with USA a while back, and just playing against each other. I mean, we all have a mutual respect, and getting to know each other has just been a blast. I've had so much fun playing with these guys, and I hope that we could continue to do that for a while longer.
Your parents are here, your wife is here. Think back on your journey. Who are the people that you want to thank the most for putting you here in this U.S. uniform?
My mom, my dad. From the get-go, I've been, you know, playing ball as long as I can remember. I was out in the backyard when I was 2 years old throwing a little t-ball around. So it's been a lot of fun, and I really appreciate everything my folks have done for me.
Danny, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Nice job,
thanks.
JP, thanks. A 1-2-3 inning by Tyler Clipper takes us to the bottom of the sixth. The U.S. still in control on top, 7-0. Some changes for Team Canada as Christian Yelich digs in to start the home sixth. Big Padres prospect Josh Naylor takes over at first. And Chris LaRue takes over on the mound. 2016 numbers as Toronto property at Triple-A Buffalo. Chris is a free agent as we speak, 32-year-old native of Montreal. 10 seasons in the minors with a variety of different employers. He's playing in the World Baseball Classic for the third time. He was here in 09 and in 2013. Foul ball.
Throws a little bit across his body and a little lower arm release. He closes himself off. When you watch it first come to home plate, watch that front shoulder go more towards third base. So the only way is to come around and throw a little bit across his body and create movement with the two seamer. Watch his front shoulder as soon as he goes.
Strikes out Christian Yelich. Easier said than done in this tournament. That's the first time Christian has struck out in 2.5 days here. And now Nolan Arenado, who got himself on track in the second inning with a big 3-run home run. Pitch to the two-time All-Stars fouled away.
Well, this home run by StatCast, powered by Amazon Web Services. This ball is absolutely smoked. Head down, textbook hitting, 104 miles an hour, and on a rope. 404 feet. Had to feel good.
As a layman, I don't understand enough about the science of hitting to be able to properly explain why Nolan Arenado looks different at the plate than a lot of players. But it always looks like he's hitting down on the baseball. And for him to go down there, hit a home run, or even hit a fly ball, almost defies the conventional science.
Believe it or not, when they tell you to hit a high ball, that's what they're telling you to do. Get on top, hit down, create backspin. when you swing up, you're never going to hit a high pitch. That's more for low ball hitters, but being able to have the technique and stay back without lunging and get tremendous backspin after you hit it, that's what he does.
Not to mention, just from a purely observational kind of artistic view, he swings angry. He's up there to do damage, JP.
He is, Matt, and a great story told by Mike Gonzalez, Arenado's high school coach. Arenado made the All-Star team last year, played the All-Star game at Petco Park, went 0-for-3. The game-ending double play was off his bat, off of Zach Britton's sinker, which is certainly no great sin in this game. But the next day, he wasn't happy with his at-bats. So he calls his coach, Mike Gonzalez, and says, "Coach, I didn't like my at-bats in the All-Star game. Can we hit for a while?" So he drives up to his old high school, El Toro High School, Southern California, to get some hacks in because he wanted to get a little work in, a little tune-up, Matt, the day after the All-Star game.
Well, I love stories like that. That's what the great ones do. I mean, there's a story about the great late Tony Gwynn, who in the middle of his consecutive run of batting titles had a day off after a game at New York playing the Mets and went to the Class A, was it the Northwest League? No, this the Class A team, that the league that Albany plays in.
Eastern League?
Eastern League. No, that's a Double A league. Yeah, anyway, he drove up to a Low A league in upstate New York and watched a bunch of kids play for that same reason, just to kind of change it up, do something different, take advantage of that off day. The New York Penn League is where he visited. And Nolan, per JP's story, just going back to chat with his high school coach. I love it. I know that Nolan Arenado has been a fan of this event as well, JP. I know he watched it in 2006 at home. He went to the event in 2009.
A dream. It's been a dream for him, Matt, to now be on the team. Actually, his father, Fernando, when he got here to the first game Team USA played, he took a picture of the scoreboard, his father did, to see his son batting third for Team USA in this tournament. And speaking about Nolan in general, his enthusiasm for working out and his passion for playing the game, how about this photo from the El Toro High School alumni game over the winter time? Here he is with a dirty t-shirt there, straight out of Southern California. That's his coach, Mike Gonzalez, in the middle there, and Austin Romine on the other side. Nolan, Matt, was the all-time shortstop in that game. Didn't want to risk actually stepping in the batter's box, but he played all-time shortstop in shorts, as you see there, diving all over the place, getting a dirty shirt.
That's great. He's a good one for sure. Two down now for Eric Hosmer. Oh, the Rockies got some bad news out of camp today.
They sure did. Ian Desmond, who they just newly acquired, fractured hand.
1-1.
Believe hit by a pitch.
Ball and a strike to count to Eric Hosmer. Bounced out to Josh Naylor. The new first baseman picks it up and gets the bag in time. U.S. goes down 1-2-3 in the sixth. On to the seventh inning tonight. It's still 7-0 for the Americans. Miami to a game that the U.S. has never trailed. A 7-0 score starting the top of the seventh. Danny Duffy was terrific tonight. 4 shutout innings, 7 strikeouts. Nolan Arenado has contributed with a 3-run home run. The Americans got 3 in the first, 4 in the second, and we have stayed at 7-0 ever since. So Tyler O'Neill opens the Canadian half of the seventh. 4-5-6 batters for Canada as Tyler Clippard continues for his second inning tonight.
Yeah, that first inning was so quick. Throw him back out there and let him get his full allotment of work in. Day off tomorrow. They hold on to this victory.
Ball and 2 strikes to Seattle prospect Tyler O'Neill. As part of the Canadian order, has gone hitless. In fact, only 3 hits tonight for Team Canada as O'Neill strikes out. Second punch out for the reliever Tyler Clippard in an inning and a third. So now Justin Morneau still looking for his first hit in WBC play this year.
Seeing live pitching so much different than just taking batting practice and getting your swings in and getting your timing down. And that, for the most part, I know a lot of players claim that, you know, spring training's too long. And they only need so many different plate appearances, but it's not universal. Not everybody can hone in on their craft really quickly.
Well, and you consider that in the case of Justin Morneau, he missed the first half of last year after recovering from offseason elbow surgery. So it wasn't like he had a regular season run last year anyway. Swing and a miss that's hung on to for strikeout and out number two. Three strikeouts for Tyler Clifford. That's 12 strikeouts for American pitching tonight. Two away now for Jamie Romack. He has struck out twice tonight. As we mentioned, Jamie Romack's wearing a microphone tonight.
Melby will go after, guys. Gonna need a new one. Wait, Freddy!
I love that. Shatters his bat, looks down, gonna need a new one. 0-2 the count to Jamie Romack. Clifford a strike away from striking out the side in the seventh, something that Danny Duffy did to open the ball game.
Clippers look really good, and that as you progress in this tournament and in spring training, I would expect each guy getting his reps in a bullpen to correct what may not have gone right or improve on the continual mastering of your mechanics and pitches.
Still the ball and two strikes.
The one luxury these guys do not have, however, and it's the one maybe tiny criticism of being ready fast, is you don't have a chance to really bring or work on something. So if you're bringing in another pitch or you want to upgrade a pitch, that's going to be kind of on the side work in the bullpen. Tough to bring that in this kind of arena when you want to win and move on.
Yeah, there's no training curve here at all. The next 1-2 from Clifford. Got him swinging. He does, in fact, strike out the side. 13 strikeouts for U.S. pitching. Seventh inning stretch in Miami. It's been an American story in the nightcap of our doubleheader. 7-0 Team USA. Welcome back to this World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network, presented by GEICO. Some changes as we go to the U.S. half of the seventh with Team USA on top, 7-0. Paul Goldschmidt the first to face the new pitcher, veteran right-hander Jim Henderson. Daniel Pinero takes over at shortstop, making his first World Baseball Classic appearance. Henderson with big league service time in Milwaukee and New York, among other places. Last year with the Mets, 44 appearances out of the bullpen. An ERA just over 4, pitched on Thursday and gave up a run on 3 hits in the third of an inning against the Dominican Republic.
He's dealt with some injuries, as do a lot of the pitchers. You see the lower three quarter release slot that he'll throw his slider that doesn't have a huge break, but he throws across his body, which creates a different look for a right-handed hitter.
Goldschmidt 0 for 2 with a walk so far tonight. Swing and a miss as Henderson finishes him off for strikeout victim. And there's one away. So again, Team USA hangs on and wins this one. They guarantee their spot in San Diego next week. They will join the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico. And if Venezuela can beat Mexico later tonight, Venezuela has the four teams involved in that next round.
And if that is what we indeed have, I'd be very impressed if somebody went 3-0 in that bracket.
Yeah, it's a good call. Oh, and one to Buster Posey, make it 0-2. By the way, if you're going to be looking for that game from Jalisco, Mexico later on tonight, chances are we're still going to be on the air when that one starts. And you'll be able to find Venezuela and Mexico on MLB.TV. A ball and two strikes to Buster Posey. Naylor hoping for a play. It's well into the seats. You know, Jim Leland told us before the tournament began that with only two catchers on the roster, whoever starts the night behind the plate is likely to finish it. This isn't like a spring training environment where you can call somebody up from the backfields or from a minor league roster and give your starting catcher a blow after the fourth inning. Buster Posey caught game one. Lucroy got yesterday's game, and Posey back there for all nine, presumably tonight. There's a drive, well hit to left. That one doesn't have a chance to stay in the park. Buster Posey goes deep.
Sets it on his back and gets ready to deliver that blow right there.
Ball one.
See how it gets in the hitting position and just looks really good.
There has not been a more productive catcher over the last five seasons, offensively speaking, than Buster Posey. It's 1-1 to Giancarlo Stanton. You know, it's hard to imagine with that quiet swing you talk about, John, and knowing what he's capable of, his going through the kind of home run drought he went through last year. Career long 49 game stretch without a home run. It's the kind of thing that has the conversation flying around San Francisco that maybe at some point Buster Posey moves to first base full time. He's not ready for that yet.
But I think that's a good conversation. And one that. That's a demanding position. You need a freakish body that's flexible, that can maintain the rigors of being down there behind the plate, stress on the knees, catching all those games. The good news is for him, at least it's in an environment where, you know, talking about 95 every day. It's cool.
It's true.
It's just a tougher part to hit. He's got to crush the ball to get it out.
Three balls and a strike to Stanton. full count now. Swing and a miss. Second time Stanton has struck out tonight. Again, the big picture, if the U.S. hangs on and defeats Canada here, they advance to San Diego to join the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico. And if Venezuela can win tonight and they start at 10 Eastern with Mexico, Venezuela would be in the group. There's Brandon Crawford now pinch hitting with two out in the inning. Josh Harrison's grabbed a bat for the first time in the tournament. He stands in the on deck circle. Strike to Brandon Crawford. I think a lot of the players for Team USA have enjoyed the alternate gear that they're able to wear, the stars and stripes stuff, whether it's an elbow pad that's decorated differently, wristbands, shoes. Crawford into the opposite corner. That ball's well hit. O'Neill's back there, and it's off the wall. A stand-up double for Brandon Crawford, his second double of the night. Brandon Crawford likes coming to South Florida. Yes, he's a Northern California native, a lifelong Giants guy. But let's take you back to August of this past season. A seven hit game, something no player had done in 41 years. Yeah, it was a 14 inning affair. But only five players since 1913 have managed to reach the seven hit mark in a single game. Rennie Stennett was the last to do so as a Pirate in 1975.
That's a good week.
It's amazing. I think it was that seven hit game that Rennie Stennett had as a Pirate that netted him a huge contract to go to the Giants. 0-2 to current Pirate Josh Harrison, who, by the way, represents the winning run in a respect. Because as you can see, the early termination rules, Josh hits a two run home run here and the game's over. Ten or more run lead after seven innings means good night. We'll settle with a fly ball out to right, and in right center, Rene Tassone makes the catch to keep things going into the top of the eighth. 8-0 Team USA. Well, the U.S. got three in the first and they really haven't looked back. They added four in the second, one more on the Buster Posey home run a moment ago, and they take an 8-0 lead to the top of the eighth inning. Six outs away from advancing to San Diego. A couple of changes defensively. We'll post those for you in a moment. Rene Tassone leads things off for Canada. Tassone, Kataris, and Pinero, the bottom third of the order for Canada.
Jake McGee in the game, and someone who forgot to take the hanger out of his jersey. Oh wait, those are his wide shoulders. His broad back and over the top and throwing a lot of fastballs with the Rockies.
And in front of Rene Tassone, a ball and two strikes. Saw Josh Harrison, who sticks around in the ballgame as well, help play the rest of the night at second base in place of Ian Kinsler. Josh has this Stylin wristband on his left forearm there with his own picture on it. You know you've arrived when there's an order for wristbands with your face on it.
2-2.
Two balls and two strikes.
I enjoy watching him play. I really do. He's athletic, can play multiple positions.
Got a big heart too, very generous, spends a lot of time with youth in Cincinnati, his hometown. He and his family, they put on a series of clinics in the offseason to help kids that don't really have a chance to play organized baseball. It's two balls and two strikes to Tassoni.
Into a new position, gets tested early usually.
That's into left center field, and that's going to split Jones and Yelich. Rene Tassoni on his way into second base with his first hit of the night, a leadoff double. It happens only once every 4 years. The World Baseball Classic is finally here. Don't miss your chance to see the best players represent their country. Get your tickets now at worldbaseballclassic.com. Coming to San Diego. A chance for George Kitaris now to knock in a run. Veteran catcher has singled tonight. The U.S. has never gotten past round two. They are now five outs away from getting to round two. So now the shortstop. And one of the late F troopers that was involved in the game. Daniel Pinero.
Well, for Canada, it's been a rough first three games. They've had trouble scoring. Looks like it's back to a qualifier round if this holds up.
Oh, and two to Pinero. Talked about earlier in the tournament, Ernie Witt's been around for so much of Team Canada's international play as a manager. He's about as important a figure in Canadian baseball history as one could come up with. A member of the inaugural Blue Jays team back in 1977. He was an all-star in 85 when they went to the postseason for the first time. Has not gone the way he drew it up, for sure. Right. 65 and 27 are his teams in international play, at least at the start of the WBC. Spent some time as the Phillies roving catching instructor and on the Blue Jays coaching staff for 4 years. Had a great career. I mentioned the All-Star year in 85.
That was a teammate of Ernie Witt.
Yeah, I hadn't realized that until you guys exchanged greetings earlier.
The Atlanta Braves.
Two balls and two strikes, the count to Daniel Pinero, who could have played for Canada by virtue of his birth country.
3-2.
Could have played for Cuba. His dad, in fact, played for the Cuban national team. And Daniel Pinheiro could have played for Russia if they had fielded a team in this event. His mom's Russian.
Who could you have played for?
Nobody.
Nobody?
Nobody would, nobody would have me.
No, I mean, you know.
Based on ethnicity?
Yeah.
I could have played for Armenia.
Okay.
We dominate, like, table games, cards and stuff. These are the eligibility guidelines. A player previously appeared on a final roster at the start of a WBC qualifier. You're born there. If you're eligible for citizenship, a permanent legal resident, or if your parent was born there or is a former citizen. Now you, on the other hand, could have played for Team USA.
Yep.
Could have played for Team Italy.
Yep.
Team Poland. No?
No.
There's no Polish blood?
Yugoslavia.
Okay. What am I missing?
Probably German.
Probably? Full count, 3 balls and 2 strikes to Pinheiro.
Ball four.
And there's ball four. JP, this is one of your great passions. Eligibility by birth country.
Dziękuję bardzo. That would be thank you very much in Polish, my friend. I think they were adding maybe one more language to it to the broadcast there. So a little Polish there. But yes, it's true. That's why actually you see Team Italy be so strong. Many Italian Americans, Team Israel very strong, many Jewish Americans. So that's part of the eligibility rules, as you point out, just to be eligible for the passport, not to actually have it. Much in the same way, Matt, is I don't actually speak these languages. I just know I know enough to fool you. You know, that's basically how it works.
Well, as we know that John and I are easily fooled. You slap on an accent, we're pretty much ready to go to that place with you. So your accents are good. You know just enough of parts of 6 or 7 languages to be very convincing for us.
Shishia. Thank you.
0-1 the count to Pete Orr.
Did he sneeze or what did he?
Thank you in Mandarin,
oh,
I believe.
Nice.
Was that Mandarin, JP?
That was Mandarin.
Okay.
Very good. See, Hung Hao, very good, Matt.
Okay.
Excellent.
A strike to Orr to make it 0-2. And there are 2 gone in the inning. In the last WBC, Canada and the U.S. got together in a much more closely played affair. Canada led by a run in the 8th before the bullpen unraveled. Adam Jones had a big 2-run double. Eric Hosmer put it out of reach. It was a close game until the end when Canada lost 9-4, failing to advance to the second round. U.S. got there and were eliminated in round number 2 in 2013. The U.S. did get to the semis in 2009. As I stand corrected from an earlier statement, I'm trying to go even deeper than that this year. It's going to be all for Jake McGee. Jim Leland makes a pitching change, and we'll be right back. The runners aboard, rather, and 2 gone in the Canada half of the 8th, trying to preserve the shutout. 8-0 Team USA. Eric Wood greets him with a first pitch swing and a high fly ball for Josh Harrison. And that'll do it in the 8th. The U.S. getting closer to stamping its passport, if you will, to San Diego. 8-0 Americans. This World Baseball Classic telecast on MLB Network is presented by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. And sponsored in part by Bud Light, famous among friends. And by Wendy's. Beef. Adam Jones leads things off in the last of the 8th with a shot into the left field corner. And that'll bound off the wall. A first pitch double for Adam Jones to open the home 8th. second hit of the ball game for Adam, and now we're in the same spot that we talked about in the last of the seventh, where a home run can force the victory. Dustin Mollican on the mound, the fifth pitcher used in this one by Team Canada.
Strike one.
Christian Yelich has been terrific in this tournament. There's a little theme here with this group of hitters: Jones, Yelich, Arenado. All Southern California guys, JP.
They are, and Yelich was one of a couple USA players earlier today, Matt, who was telling me, we want to bring this tournament back to where we're from, SoCal, and play the Dominican Republic one more time on Saturday on our turf, so to speak. Certainly probably more of a pro U.S. crowd on Saturday at Petco Park than what we had last night here at Marlins Park, but they want that rematch. They don't like the way that game ended last night. They think it got away from them. And Yelich and Eric Hosmer, others said, you know what, we want that team again. We want them in San Diego on Saturday night.
Yeah, and you'd think that because the proximity here between Miami and the Dominican, and because of the big Dominican fan base that's already here and in New York, not sure they'll have that kind of support on the West Coast. They'll have support, but I don't know it's going to be as demonstrative as it was yesterday. That one bounces away from Kataris, and Jones gets down to third. The team that would have made the most noise in San Diego and LA is the team from Mexico, but they're really up against it. In fact, they're just getting started now with Venezuela, and if you're looking for that game, it's on MLB.tv. If Venezuela wins, they join Puerto Rico from that pool in advancing to San Diego. If Mexico wins, there's a three-way tie, and the tiebreaker scenarios will have to play out. In fact, that game is starting in less than 10 minutes. Into the corner in foul territory, and run down out there on a fine running catch. Eric Wood covered a lot of ground.
Would have been interesting in a tighter game to see what Adam Jones would have done on that ball.
The pinch hitter is Alex Bregman. Finally getting an opportunity after all to break the seal on his WBC career. He hits for Nolan Arenado, and if needed, he will get out there and play third base in the ninth. What a terrific future in front of this former first rounder. A 300 batting average in the minors last year between AA and AAA. Made his debut in July and struggled out of the gate. Then got a vote of confidence from his manager A.J. Hinch in the midst of a terrible swoon. A.J. pulled him aside right before the game began and said, look, you're our best hitter. I know you're not going real good, but I'm going to bat you second tomorrow. And he said, wait a minute, I'm your best hitter? Yeah, you're my best hitter. And this is a roster, a lineup with the likes of Carlos Correa and a bunch of established players. From there, Bregman took off, and I don't think he's ever going to slow down.
That's a nice lineup they're going to have this year, the Astros. They made some nice additions: Brian McCann, Beltran. They get some pitching, they're going to be tough.
He's just less than 2 years removed from his collegiate days at LSU. A swing and a miss. He goes down on strikes, and there are two away. So here's Eric Hosmer for a fifth time now.
George, I hope I see
Hosmer that. Sends a drive into center field that is handled by Tassone. George, And we're going to the ninth. The U.S. is three outs away from a shutout win and a trip to San Diego. The U.S. is those three outs away from advancing in the World Baseball Classic and making a date for themselves in San Diego next week. Nate Jones gets a first pitch swing and a one pitch out off the bat of Josh Naylor. There's one gone. Well, it's been quite a long night of baseball. After the long extra innings victory by the Dominican Republic, Team USA knew that they had one thing to do: come out here, win, handle their own business, and advance, and not defer to any tiebreakers or any play-in games. And that's exactly what's happened.
Well, they know they're a good ball club, and so is the Dominican Republic. I mean, I don't think anyone's shocked, other than the great admiration for the Colombian team and what they almost pulled off in this World Baseball Classic. That was some of the most exciting baseball that you didn't expect coming in. We didn't know what to expect. And I think the fact that Dominican and the U.S. are going to a loaded pool, whoever survives and moves on to San Diego is going to be really exciting to watch.
Yeah, the only chair that'll be unclaimed is that fourth team. We know the DR is moving on. Puerto Rico moves on. If the U.S. can get these final two outs, they'll be there. And then we'll wait for the results of Mexico and Venezuela getting started in minutes on MLB.TV to figure out who'll join them. And in fact, as soon as we're off the air, we'll take you out there live to Jalisco, Mexico. Two balls and two strikes to Tyler O'Neill.
You ever watched four games in one day?
Only in the World Baseball Classic, only in this event, but I don't know that I've been as locked on to the four games as we have today.
Yeah, I mean, the first game, wee hours of this morning, was exciting, extra innings.
Japan and the Kingdom of the Netherlands, yeah.
And then we got to call these two games and probably hang out in the lobby and watch the fourth game.
Yeah. And, by the way, we were doing our best to pay attention to the Italy-Puerto Rico game this afternoon from Jalisco. So really five games in the day. This one lost a lot of its, you know, compelling storyline because Danny Duffy was impossible to solve. U.S. starting pitching has been terrific.
It really has. He came out and just established each pitch, struck out the side, sat for about 12 minutes while his team rewarded him for three runs. And did the same thing in the second inning with a zero up, and before you know it, 7-0.
Here's Justin Morneau now. He represents the last chance for the Canadians. There were moments when the U.S. fate was far from a guarantee here in Miami. They needed extra innings to upend Colombia. After the loss yesterday to the Dominican Republic, a loss that came despite a 5-0 mid-game lead, the U.S. knew they had to win today. But when the tiebreaker math was really investigated, when we got into that and learned that a Colombia win could have been a disaster for the U.S., people were a little nervous. Those nerves have calmed down as of right now. The first order of business handled for Jim Leland as the Americans shut out Canada and have advanced in the tournament.